Okay, hi to everybody. It's a pleasure to have you here today. Today there will be this talk by Andrea Borsato on an agent-based stock flow consistent model for secular stagnation in the US, theory and empirical evidence. So Andrea is a PhD student at the University of Tuscany, basically in Siena. So he's about to defend his dissertation in the next weeks. But he's already postdoc at the Beta University of Strasbourg. So I'm very happy that in our seminar of IBM for Policy, we can also discuss the works of PhD student and postdocs in order to help them and to improve what they are doing. So Andrea, you have the floor, 40 minutes. And we look forward to hearing from you what you have to say.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. I wish to thank all of you to give me the chance to present myself and to expound the main avenue, the main line of research I deepened and studied during my PhD program. As Andrea said, just to give you some information about myself, I belong to the Department of Economics and Statistics at the University of Siena. I'll be soon a postdoc researcher at Beta University of Strasbourg. And during my PhD thesis, I focused on the problem of secular stagnation in the United States from either a theoretical or empirical point of view. Precisely, I wrote three papers in which I first gave my own definition of secular stagnation after a simple but careful data analysis. And then I developed an agent-based stock flow consistent model to provide my own explanation why the United States are characterized by secular stagnation. Finally, in the last part of the thesis, I've also carried out a panel co-integration analysis as to check whether the crucial results of my model find adherence in the data. For what concerns to my presentation today, no, my slides don't go ahead. I have a problem with my slides. Okay. For what concerns to my presentation today, I chose to make a general recap of what I studied in my thesis. I will start with one of the research questions I gave an answer in the first paper, namely, is secular stagnation a fact? And then I will show you the main the highlights of the agent-based model I developed. In other words, I'll focus on a few of the most interesting, the most important, and then I will show you the main results from my model. Finally, if I have enough time, I'll talk a bit about the econometric analysis, but just if I have enough time. As you will see, I've written plenty of slides with all the possible rationales the literature has found for the research of secular stagnation and all the equation results from my model. However, as you imagine, I'll skip most of them. I put them into the slides just to satisfy any possible curiosity or question from you from the floor. Well, the mediocre performances experienced by many economic systems in terms of GDP or productivity growth rates in the aftermath of the crisis led several economists, first of all, Larry Summers, to revive the old concept of secular stagnation. Since this debate tends to be raised whenever a strong recession takes place, the first research question I'll try to give you an answer today is, is secular stagnation a fact? And then, in which way does the distribution of income between wages and profits affect the innovative pattern of an economy and the subsequent attainments in productivity? Is it plausible that the decrease in the labor share impacted negatively on innovation activities and productivity for a demand channel? May secular stagnation have originated from that? These are basically the research questions I'll try to give an answer today. But what is secular stagnation? The concept has been introduced in the economic fields by Alvin Hansen to describe the summer situation in which the US economy fell after the Great Depression in 1929. The claim looked at the high unemployment as the principal problem for the Americans. And the expression stood for the sick recoveries which die in their infancy and depressions which feed on themselves leave a hard and seemingly immovable core of unemployment. Hansen believed the events occurred in the first quarter of the 20th century constituted a profound structural change not smaller than the one provoked by the Industrial Revolution, and he stressed on three main causae causantes of the stagnating growth process: adjusted decline in population growth rate, changes in the character of technological innovations, and the availability of new technologies. Basically, as this factor made possible the industrial development in many Western economies, the reversal of the previous pattern caused the downturn of economic progress and activities. In contrast, for the 50s and the 60s, the turn was associated with the permanent slowdown in capital accumulation or economic growth that some economists, mainly Stendhal, foresaw for mature capitalist economies due to their natural tendency toward increasing oligopolistic concentration or decreasing profit rates. Today, many economists like Summers or Gordon dealt with this phenomenon, and each of them provided his own definition. And from that, we can understand why secular stagnation is like the Rorschach test, that means different things to different people. Since it is quite harder to detect the evidence of secular stagnation by looking solely at a unique macroeconomic indicator, I decided to take a historical perspective in order to see which characteristics associated with secular stagnation are found in the data. In particular, I focused on US macroeconomic indicators since late 19th century when possible, about GDP growth, GDP per capita growth, productivity measure, potential output on population. Today, for simplicity, I limit the exposition to GDP and productivity measure. In this first picture, I plotted the growth rate of GDP per capita since 1870. What can we see from this picture is that the actual pattern of GDP growth has been trendless throughout the period. In other terms, we can interpret the hump and the subsequent decrease in GDP growth as the return to the average growth performance before the golden age of capitalism, which represents like a kind of anomaly in the history of capitalism. In this way, we shouldn't consider secular stagnation, current weak performances in GDP growth as a symptom of secular stagnation. However, we obtain very different results for what concerns to labor productivity. The second picture documents the pattern followed by labor productivity growth since 1889. And what makes the secular stagnation hypothesis consistent with data is the slow, steady, and significantly declining growth throughout the period. In particular, we see that the growth pattern was trendless till World War II, and it started decline since the middle of the Golden Age. And this decline has been so strong as to make the overall trend globally decreasing. In this third picture constitutes kind of a zoom. Here we can appreciate the steady decline in growth, in the trend growth since the second half of the Golden Age. Moreover, I found many structural breaks in the time series, especially in the 70s and in the 90s. For what concerns to TFP growth, the story is almost the same. And my estimates are neither qualitative nor quantitative different from the ones provided by Gordon in his several studies on the topic. In particular, we notice that the period 1920-1950 benefited from the highest growth, with rates strictly above 2% on average, while subsequent periods never exhibit a rate of growth on average above 2%. So we should answer positively to the first question, and we should define secular stagnation as the tendency to the long-term slowdown in the growth rates of labor and multifactor productivities, along with a return to pre-golden age average GDP growth. And this tendency rises in the early 70s and reaches the trough with the Great Recession in 2007. Moreover, we should speak about secular stagnation from a historical perspective that involves more long runs or a more extended long run. What does it mean? usually economists consider a period a long run as a period of 40-50 years, while for an economic historian, this is still a short run. In this way, we should frame secular stagnation into a historical perspective that involves a century at least. But the epoch described by Hansen doesn't look like a period of secular stagnation at all. There are three reasons, but the common factor is that he underestimated the potential of what technologies were already known in his time. Now, since I prefer talking about my model, I leave for future discussion or curiosities all the relevant explanation the literature has found for secular stagnation, with the respective pros and cons. If you're interested in them, we can discuss later. Now, I want to skip and talk about my model. The literature on secular stagnation paid indeed little attention to the interplay between the functional distribution of income, innovation and productivity. In particular, there's a lack of a demand-side channel. So the second research question is, in which way does the distribution of income between wages and profits affect the innovative pattern of an economy and the subsequent attainments in productivity? Is it plausible that the decrease in the labor share impacted negatively on innovation activity and productivity through a demand channel, raising the problem of secular stagnation in the US? To reply, I developed an agent-based stock flow consistent model in which this, the functional distribution of income and innovative search play a pivotal role, a focal role. However, is this methodology necessary? Does it allow to show us any insight to which is not visible with standard methodologies like the representative agent models or a more aggregate perspective? To my specific purpose, there are two main channels at work. The first route is the macro to micro channel. In that we have crucial phenomena, like for instance, the social conflict between workers and entrepreneurs that occur at the macroeconomic level. And they affect entrepreneurial decision about employment, innovative efforts from a cost side. On the other hand, we have aggregate demand that from households that endogenously shapes production and the way production and pricing decisions are taken by the entrepreneurs. This is from a revenue side. The second route, the micro to macro channel, is essential because firms' competitiveness, the market structure, or innovative search affect the innovation rates on aggregate and productivity dynamics. And remember that I define the secular stagnation as taking the specific form of an aggregate productivity matter. Then there are other reasons on why we should prefer agent-based model with respect to standard representative agent models or a more aggregate perspective, but these are quite common to the literature and I won't deepen them now. Well, many fields of research define the background literature of this work. First, the literature on secular stagnation, as I said, here defined as the tendency to the long-term slowdown in productivity growth. Second, we have the Schumpeterian and evolutionary literature that deals with the innovation as the driving force of economic growth and development. Moreover, the innovation is very related with uncertainty and complex modes of behavior. Finally, we have the agent-based stock flow consistent literature that deals with systems populated by many heterogeneous interacting agents without any central coordination, like for instance, the K plus S family of models. Before starting with the model, I think it's helpful to provide again some data. In this first figure, I want to show you a well-documented fact, which is the decline in the wage share. In other words, which is the blue line in this picture. In other words, we experience there has been a significant shift of income from wages to profits in the United States, as we all know. And then the wage share declined from a value of 70% to the current minimum 60%. But as I said, this is a well-documented fact in the literature. What's not often outlined is the pattern followed by R&D expenditure. The second graph documents the striking decline in R&D since the end of the golden age, in R&D growth. And that holds for federal, private, or university expenditure. Moreover, we notice that there has been a significant shift of resources of R&D expenditure from public to private institutions. However, although firms are committing a higher share of investment in R&D, it does correspond to the redirection from more scientific project to more commercially oriented project. And there's a lot of empirical evidence on that. So to go back to our question, is it plausible that the decrease in the labor share impacting negatively on innovation efforts and raising the with the impacting negatively on productivity dynamics and raising the problem of secular stagnation in the US? To reply, I focus on a one good to class closed economy with no government sector. The model is complex, adaptive, and structural in line with Tesfazio. The model is complex because it involves interacting units. It's adaptive because it experiences environmental changes, and structural because it is built on a representation of what agents do. The homogeneous good can be used either for consumption or for investment purposes. As I said, the economy is populated by many heterogeneous interacting agents without any central coordination. We have in particular first a collection N of households in which N minus F offer labor inelastically at the going wage rate, while the remaining households are capitalist. The status differs according to the propensity to save out of income, but regardless of that, everybody consumes and saves. Second, we have a collection F of firms owned by the capitalists. They produce the homogeneous good, invest in tangible capital and R&D, and apply for loans. Finally, we have a simple accommodating big bank that supplies funds to firms and collects savings from households at given interest rates. Here, a simple chart to describe what I've just said in words. Agents then interact on five markets. We have the capital good market in which firms interact with each other to buy and sell investment goods. The consumption good market in which households purchase the goods from firms. The labor market, in which the entrepreneurs hire and fire workers, in particular, I don't assume full employment at all. Full employment might occur, but it will be the very exception. We have the credit market, in which the bank provides firms with loans, and the deposit market, in which the bank gathers household savings as in the form of deposits. For what concerns to the timeline of events, I endow production firms with a unit of goods at the dawn of time. Firms then compute the target level of the capital stock. And in order to set up production, capitalists draw from previous accumulated profits or borrow funds from the banking system. Workers receive a wage, and agents, regardless of the status, spend part of their received income for consumption purposes and save what left. The bank collects interest payment from firms and pay interest to households, and capitalist managers receive a profit, if any, as a residual claim. Last step, firms update production plans, perform R&D, and any achievement in productivity will be available at T plus one, if any. Now, I wish to focus on a very few of the questions only, describing firms' investment decision and labor market. Let's have a look at equation number four, which is about R&D investment. Here I simply model the R&D accumulation rate, which is made up of two components. The first component on the right-hand side is about firms' expectation about future aggregate demand, future demand, which is computed as a moving average from past experience. The second component, which is a cost component, displays the willingness of firms to narrow the discrepancy toward a normal profit rate, which is again computed as an average from the past. Equation five is a simple physical linear physical investment function that reflects the standard accelerator functions, accelerator model. In that we have I0, which is an exogenously growing component reflecting animal spirits. The second component on the right-hand side is about the willingness to reach a target capital, a target level of the capital stock, whereas AF is the amortization fund for depreciation allowances. For what regards to the labor market, we have that the real wages don't clear the market in a variation fashion to ensure the full employment of labor. I modeled the wage as in equation 12 and 13. In that, and basically the most important factor I have to underline are W1 and W2. W1 represents all the institutional, political, social factors that balance the social conflict between workers and entrepreneurs in the society. While in contrast, W2 allows for a simple endogenization of the wage rate, in that it considers the negative influence from unemployment dynamics. For what about innovation? Firms invest on R&D to earn further profits and save labor. Innovation is very related with uncertainty and complex modes of behavior, in that since the entrepreneurs don't know whether the effort will be successful or not. I think it's useful to give you some information, some definition. We shall define with AJ the effective productivity of the JF firm at time T. With AJ, the productivity in the JF firm as a result of home R&D, and with AJI, the productivity of the JF firm as a result of imitation. For simplicity, I set all of them as equal to one at the dawn of time. The law of innovation that you see below, equation 22, is a logistic function, often used in the literature to describe the process of creation and diffusion of technologies. That basically says that the more you invest in R&D, the more probable you innovate. Every firm indeed is assigned to a random number, P-in, drawn from a uniform distribution. If this random number is lower than lambda, the firm innovates and productivity will grow according to how much you spent on R&D in the past. The imitation process follows the same law above, the same reasoning above. Think that firms are like people in the street. A single guy has a certain probability to meet somebody else. Meetings are fully random. But once a link is established, each firm has a certain probability to imitate, following the same logistic law above. In other terms, if you don't invest on technology, you won't have access to imitation. But if you invest, you will have a certain probability to copy according to how much you spent on R&D in the past. In this way, we exclude the free riders or opportunistic behavior. Finally, if the firm chooses whether to imitate, if the probability unfolds, the possibility unfolds, according to a simple comparison between productivity gains from home innovation and imitation. For what about the, let's say, the this version of the model has been run through 400 period simulation along with 100 Monte Carlo runs. As common to the other agent-based model, the system of equation doesn't allow for analytic loss-form solution. The stock flow consistency norm are respected either on aggregate or macroeconomic level, and the model is able to match a wide spectrum of stochastic of the literature. In this table, I wrote all the star aspects that was able to match with the model, but I will focus on just a few of them. Here we see that deposits equal loans every period, so the model is stock flow consistent. And for what regards to the overall behavior, the model displays endogenous and self-sustaining growth path with persistent fluctuation at the business cycle frequencies. Moreover, it doesn't suffer from Harrodian instability, which is kind of a new feature, which was highlighted for several agent-based models. Simulated time series presents strictly positive average growth and exhibit a unit root as established by the Dickey-Fuller test or the KPSS test in this table. About volatility, we have that unemployment and investment are more volatile than output and consumption, which are as much as volatile. And about microeconomic style aspect, we have that firms fall are distributed according to a log Gaussian shape, which is again in tune with the literature as clearly established, demonstrated by both Katz and Seck in their several papers. But interesting feature, I think it's an interesting feature of the model that I want to display is investment lumpiness. Basically, in this graph, we see that firms experiencing investment spikes coexist with firms having near zero investment. As we can see from the red line, which is about firms which are not investing a lot, and the blue line, which is about the share of firms which actually invest more. However, how can investment lumpiness arise with linear physical investment function? As we know, neoclassical literature used to model investment lumpiness with the usual SS threshold function, which present discontinuities. However, in my model, there are several sources of discontinuities. For instance, the firms, the matching protocol between firms and consumers, or how innovation arises and is adopted in the economy. And these discontinuities lead to further discontinuities in the investment behavior, even though I didn't model any, let's say, discontinuous function. For what concerns the policy experiments, I tested two main policy scenarios, a variety of values for the exogenous coefficient W1 and a variety of values for the interest rate on loans. The reason to test the role exerted by wages lies in the general disagreement found in the literature. On the one hand, we can argue that high wages squeeze profits and reduce investment opportunities, while keeping them in check helps increase output and employment. But on the other hand, we can argue that high wages foster aggregate demand and enhancing investment outlets for the dynamic mechanization of production. To remind, W1 is the balance of the social conflict between workers and entrepreneurs in the society. And higher value of that mean social compromises more favorable to labor. In this panel field graph, I displayed several values for W1, and what we can see is that when wages soar, entrepreneurs will be forced to introduce labor-saving innovation, which increase output, consumption, R&D investment, and productivity. However, social compromise is more favorable to labor. Entails technological unemployment. In other words, productivity and innovation increase more than output, and so the employment needs decrease, and so social compromise more favorable to laborers are counterbalanced by, let's say, an increase in the unemployment rate. About the interest rate, which is quite important on the, let's say, mainstream literature on secular stagnation. Here we see that the monotonic decreases or monotonic increase in the interest rate are not associated with the monotonic increase in the capital labor ratio. In other words, the interest rates has a nonlinear and unpredictable effect on the dynamic of output, investment, and so on. Why? Because of the contrasting movement, the interest rate spurs on the consumption innovative effort on the capitalist side. And this, I think this is quite an interesting feature of my model, I think. If I have 5 minutes more, I will talk about econometrics. Just 5 minutes at most.
Yes, you have, you can go.
Okay. To corroborate my theoretical results on distributive policies and interest rates, I carried out a panel co-integration analysis based on US manufacturing industries over the period of 1958 to 2011. I took data on R&D expenditure, wages, productivity, shipments from National Science Foundation, OECD, and NDR. The long-run econometric relationship I wish to test was quite simple in that we have as a dependent variable the R&D expenditure as a function of a cost component, wages or productivity adjusted wages, and a revenue component, which is about shipments. To estimate this long-run relation, I implemented three different integration estimators. The Pullman group, fully modified OLS, and the dynamic OLS. Before, I checked with the Pedroni panel integration test that the variables are indeed integrated. And for each of these estimators, I ran two different, let's say, model specification. But regardless of the estimators, regardless of the model specification, I found that for instance, wages or shipments are let's say significantly and positively related with R&D expenditure. In other words, it exists a long-run relationship that ties them positively. And these results are robust to a different specification of the regressors. Then I tried the same thing to find any long-run relationship between R&D and interest rate, which are, and for the interest rate, I used the effective federal funds rate and the bank prime loan rate. I carried out the panel co-integration test, but the Pedroni test, let's say, told me that it doesn't exist any long-run relationship between them. In other words, the variables are not co-integrated. It doesn't mean that any coefficient estimated will be spurious because the variables are not related between each other in the long run. And this, in other words, doesn't, go in conflict. It's not in conflict with the results of my model. To conclude, this is the last slide. I set secular stagnation in the evolutionary framework and provided some insights to explain the problems that affect US economy since 1972. I developed an agent-based flow consistent model to analyze the relationship between income distribution, innovation, and productivity growth. The main result is that redistributions of income are favorable to profits underperforms innovative activity, and the system will experience a lower growth rates in terms of productivity. As a result, the interest rate has a nonlinear effect either on innovative effort or on economic growth. And finally, I found favorable empirical evidence on a panel of US manufacturing industries since 1958 for my prediction. I stop here. I really thank you for your attention, and I'm ready and willing to answer to any curiosity about what I said. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot, Andrea. So while I'm waiting for people to ask questions, so you can write in the chat if you want to ask questions. I just take the advantage of being the chair, and I have some comments, some questions. Well, the first one is just a minor note. In the very beginning, we're referring to the evolutionary and Schumpeterian literature. Well, it's not really Hagen and Howitt there, but what you should put is Nelson and Winter and Dodge. Yeah. So be careful about that. The second thing, at some point you mentioned the fact that agent-based models are not, display error instability or something like that. I don't know if I got it well, but I would like you to develop more on that. And then my last comment is about the secular stagnation, in the sense that, it's not clear to me what is your model is showing in terms of secular stagnation. I mean, do you have some run where at some point this emerge, or some run where it does not emerge, and so in a clear way you can single out all these possible conditions? I mean, I think you have shown here and there, okay, but I would like you to make a sort of general wrap up. Then I think. Also, Mauro has a question, and maybe Mauro Napoletano can raise a question, and then you can reply to this first round, and then we see if other people want to talk. Please, Mauro, go on.
Yes, hello to everyone. So thanks very much for the presentation. My question is related to the one of Andrea. Could you please clarify a bit better what is the main mechanism that should generate secular stagnation in the model? So this is the first question. The second one is So you said that the model may display some erosion stability. I think this is a very interesting issue, and I would like to ask you whether you can give some more comments on that. Thank you very much.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Okay, I start replying to this one.
You can reply to this, Andrea. There are already, I mean, a couple of two or three questions. So I think it's, you have plenty of
okay,
things.
Okay, about erosion instability. Basically, I wrote the very recent papers by Botte, Franke, and Emanuele Russo. Basically, Botte and Franke show that agent-based models, if they don't have any, let's say, stabilizing mechanism, like, for instance, exogenous labor force or others, basically suffer from erosion instability. And the only taming force is about, for instance, full employment or, let's say, like a sailing or the collapse of the economy. And these limits basically help taming the model. It's they are very recent papers. While on the other hand, Emanuele Russo showed that inserting into the model heterogeneous agents, these can constitute like a let's say a taming force for erosion instability. So basically, these papers. Each of them highlights the advantage of the disadvantage of using agent-based modeling according to the different assumption. For what regards to my model, it doesn't suffer from erosion instability because there are several mechanisms that basically are counterbalance each other. One of them is that there is R&D, there is innovation. And so basically the increase in unemployment rates, let's say spurred by aggregate demand is counterbalanced by an increase in productivity for innovation, which decreases the amount of employment needed. Then there are, even in the R&D investment function, there are contrasting movements. The cost, the revenue component increases the amount of R&D investment as aggregate demand grows. But as aggregate demand grows, labor power grows again. And if labor power grows, the profit rates decrease. And if profit rates decrease, again, the investment in R&D goes down. So there is a counterbalancing effect, which helps taming again the erosion instability. And the other feature are, basically these are the only feature in my model that helps, that explain why erosion instability is not a huge problem in my model. About secular stagnation, the main mechanism in my model is this one. I denote secular stagnation as a productivity growth decline, a trend declining productivity growth. Of course, since my model is not neoclassical, I don't rely on TFP growth, but just on labor productivity. Basically, the mechanism is this one. Since the social conflict between workers and entrepreneurs has two components, an exogenous component, institutional factors, let's say, an endogenous one, which is unemployment dynamics, a social conflict favorable to labor, so increasing wages, just to simplify, can prevent the rise of secular stagnation. However, as we know from Stahl's facts, a decrease in the labor power or a decrease in the labor share influenced negatively entrepreneurs' willingness to undertake innovative investment on the microeconomic level. So there is a first channel from macro to micro dynamics. And then if the innovative search decreases, productivity improvements decreases at the same time. And so we have a decline in the growth rate of labor productivity, which is a positive function of the innovative investment at firm level. These are basically the mechanisms that lead to secular stagnation. However, what my model found is the role about the rate of interest on loans. Basically, Larry Summers, basically the theory of secular stagnation as revived by Larry Summers, said simply that we are now living a period of secular stagnation of weak growth performance because the interest rate has reached, the natural interest rate has reached a negative or very low value. However, in my model, they are not negative or low value of interest rate are not a huge problem because the interest rate on loans affect either the consumption out of capitalist and housing in general and innovative investment, innovative search on the other. And both of them counterbalance each other and the effect of interest rate on innovative effort and productivity and economic growth are non-linear and let's say unpredictable. This is the main, these are the main mechanism. I'm not sure if I've been clear, but tell me if you need.
No, for me was okay. I don't know if for Mauro Napoletano, I guess.
Okay, just to be brief. So if I, besides the, what you said on interest rates, so if I understand well, so if there is an increase in the labor share, there will be a decrease in the profit rate, and so there will be lower investment in R&D. There is an effective demand.
Just standard. Half of the equation, yes. If you just half of the equation, because the equation on R&D, let me show you. Okay, this is the accumulation rate of R&D, the behavioral equation. The first term on the right-hand side is about expectation on future aggregate demand. So higher labor share, higher aggregate demand for consumption good, and so R&D goes up. But this is a cost component in that firms wish to narrow the discrepancy toward a normal profit rate, which is again computed as a moving average from the past. Past profit rates. So higher labor share in the model, let's say, sparse innovative investment, because basically the decline in profit rates is more than counterbalanced by the increase in the labor share, by increasing of aggregate demand. That's the main reason.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Are there other questions? From the audience, please take the, please, I mean, talk, I mean, don't be shy. So, well, if there are no other questions, I really thank you, Andrea, for being with us and for discussing your research. And I don't say good luck because you're Italian, I would say in bocca al lupo for the defense of your dissertation, and thanks again, and thanks for everybody to thank be you. Here with us for the seminar. Okay, bye to everybody. Ciao.
Ciao, grazie.
Thank you. Bye.
Goodbye. Complimenti.
Grazie.